And here we will talk about multivariate regression. So if you are willing to understand multivariate regression, you need to know what is the concept of multivariate attribute, what is the concept of multivariate response. So here multivariate regression, generally we are dealing with multivariate response. So in univariate we had only one kind of response, univariate response, okay. But here we will come up with the multivariate response. There would be various attribute of the response, okay, or features, various features. So simply you can relate it with multivariate distribution of what we call it response. Multivariate is definitely we need to know that multivariate. So that's why intensely last class I had taken over multivariate distribution. And if you apply law of large number, then simply you can say that with the perspective of large sample theory, you can always approximate whether it is a univariate distribution or multivariate distribution. You can always approximate that by Gaussian distribution or normal distribution. So that's why I had discussed in last class in detail. So if you just you are dealing with multivariate distribution of input or attribute or feature vector, then simply PCA is providing a very good representation of the data from representation point of view. But if you want to talk about response variable as a response vector, that means there are various attribute of the response as well. So there you need to discuss about again multivariate distribution of the response vector. Here response vector we will have. In univariate model we had response variable, here we will have a response vector. So we will see how to model multivariate regression. That happens to be simplest multivariate linear model, and you can follow up further, okay. So coming to outline of today's lecture, I would like to first give a recap of multivariate Gaussian response. Okay, so you have to be very good in understanding multivariate Gaussian response, or simply I would like to say that multivariate Gaussian distribution, you need to know that. Always recall that. I have already explained that. Despite of that, you have to keep on mastering over that multivariate Gaussian distribution. Afterward, I will discuss about multivariate regression in detail. Okay, and how we can formulate multivariate regression in the framework of multiple regression. So when we are saying that multiple regression, then that time response, we are talking about response variable. We are not talking about response vector. That means just we are talking about the univariate linear model. So that is the perspective. So coming to recap of multivariate Gaussian response, as I mentioned that we try to understand multivariate normal distribution starting from a standard multivariate standard normal distribution. After that we apply a fine transformation of the multivariate standard normal distribution in order to get multivariate normal distribution. So same we had already discussed that. Just take a p variate standard normal random vector. That means this random vector is having p number of component or p number of standard normal random component. Simply we can say that each gi is happens to be a standard normal random variable, and that means mean of each gi happens to be 0 and variance happens to be 1. Variance, that is the perspective. So if you bring all those p number of standard normal random variable in together, then that means you are talking about joint distribution of p number of standard normal random variable. That means you are talking about p variate standard normal random vector. Okay, so here that means z is having p number of component, so it is a random vector. And if it is a random vector, then we will talk about associated mean vector for that random vector, and the associated covariance structure is best described by covariance matrix, and the covariance matrix for this case happens to be INT matrix. So it is just borrowed from a standard normal distribution. Okay, so here if you are willing to get an explicit form of distribution function of this p variate standard normal random variable, then you can get it through this just multiplication of individual distribution of density of individual component, because the representation is very simple due to this a simple mean and variance structure. Okay, a normalized due to normalized structure, what we are saying that. And if you further want to write in the compact form, then you can write in this form. It looks very simple, that exponential of this negative of quartic term. So again, it becomes very simple representation, and you can say that a very compact representation. The p variate density of p variate ascending normal random vector is having very compact representation. You can see it like this way. Okay, and if you are willing to see the plot for bivariate ascending normal distribution, you can see this one is coming like this way. And what is happening, that next what we do, we are applying affine transformation over the standard multivariate p normal vector, and affine transformation we carry out through a square root of this covariance matrix. Later we will call it covariance matrix, and we are taking a square root of this sigma as a scaling factor in the affine transformation, and we will take mu as a translation component in that affine transformation. So when we are someone is saying what is affine transformation, that means we are taking a vector, and that vector we multiply with a matrix. And this simply it is talking about a scaling. We do perform here a scaling. After a scaling, what we do here, we are adding a vector again. That brings a translation of this scaled version of x, a scaled version of x. So in overall, if you talk about, it is a linear transformation, but it is having affine nature. So you can simply say that affine transformation. Okay. So affine. So it is affine is just one translated version of a linear structure that we are calling it. So almost affine happens to be linear in form. Okay. So same thing. I am defining a affine transformation of a p-variate a standard normal random vector. Okay. And that scaling factor is coming through a square root of sigma, and the translation factor is coming with respect to the desired mean that we are willing to see for y. And if you are willing to talk about y is now a normal random vector, p dimensional normal random vector, and what is the mean of that? Mean is mu, mean vector is mu, and what is the covariance? Covariance is actually sigma. So simply we can claim that what would be covariance and what would we mean for y, and y is now it is non-standard normal vector, p-dimensional normal vector. And if you are willing to see the explicit form of density of y, then that one is also very simple to see it from the density of a standard normal random variable that we had already seen, that density of a standard normal random vector was symmetric and having quartic form, exponential of negative of quartic quartic form. So but here what is happening, that y is non-standard. So we will talk about the distribution of y in the vicinity of mean vector. That means mean would play the central, or you can simply say that you are changing the origin from 0 to mean vector, and that is the central quantity. And that's where if you talk about what is the density of y, then we can say that we are defining density with this normalizing constant time exponential of negative of this quartic term, where this quartic term is defined by the covariance inverse of covariance matrix, and it is centered around what mean vector. It is center. So center reference point here we are taking mu. Mu happens to be reference point. With respect to that, we are defining this quite exponential of quartic form. Okay. So very nice representation. We are getting it for even non-standard normal vector. Okay. The distribution of density of non-standard normal vector, what we are getting it here. Why we are saying that non-standard? Because here the mean is mu and variance is sigma. So that is the representation of general standard normal random vector. Okay, so now we are coming to main part of today's lecture, that here we will discuss about multivariate regression. So this one is very important from various perspective. Till now we had already seen that in linear model, generally when we are saying that anyone would like to recall what is the hypothesis function for linear model, anyone, what we do actually in linear model? No. So we are having two things in linear model, x and y. This y we are calling it response. Response x and x we are calling it attribute or input. There are various names. You can call it input or independent variable also you can call it. So input or you can call it attribute. There are various names. Or you can call it explanatory variable. There are various names, attribute. Okay. Then what you do? Actually, you are observing, you want to find the dependency of y over x. You try to model that how you model it? You model it through conditional expectation of x given y, and we say that it happens to be function of x. We want to clear the response is actually you can say that it is label or a response quantity that we are willing to estimate based on our input, like what would be response? Like suppose you are taking one human being and collecting various attribute like diet, what kind of quantity that person is eating, how much exercise that person is doing, and stretching, and various factors you are measuring, and based on that you try to come up with one response that this person will have this much. You try to predict that this person will attain this height. You try to predict that this person will get this amount of height, or this person will get that amount of weight, height, or those are just trying to get a response based on various attribute, right, various diet and exercise and other kind of things. So that is the nature of response simply we are saying. Okay, so here you try to predict about, or you try predict about response, or you try to estimate response. So that's way, and depend upon input. Okay, so here that's where your model happens to be this. We are generally saying that prediction function, the conditional expectation of y given x happens to be prediction function of y, and it is generally function of x. And in linear model I told that always I took a representation of this prediction function in the linear framework. So like in this framework, omega naught plus omega 1 time it was a linear function with linear argument x. So linear function, I am saying that the identification of function is done by these parameter omega naught and omega 1 in parametric form, and which are linear, actually in linear in nature. That's why we are saying that the model structure of this estimation function or prediction function of response happens to be linear model. It is a linear model. We are not bothering about x, whether x may come in polynomial, x may come in hyperbolic, x may come in sigmoid, whatever depends upon what kind of basis function you are willing to take. You can proceed with that. Just you have to focus on linearity with respect to parameter if you are just dealing with what we call it linear model. Okay, so we had already discussed all those things. Prior to that, in univariate and everything we had already discussed. So in today class, what we will discuss here we are taking a special case that here x happens to be. We had also seen that x might have in multiple regression, x will have multiple attribute like x1, x2, and it may go up to xp, the p-dimensional input you are taking. Okay, so this one we had already seen in case of multiple regression. One situation was that when you are performing polynomial regression, that time what you do? You translate, you transform this input vector is uni single input vector into as per your requirement into various feature vector, like x to the power 0 is 1, x to the power 1 is x, x to the power 2 is x square. And likewise, you can go, suppose you are willing to take a polynomial regression of degree p, then you can go x to the power p. So here you can observe that you are getting multiple attributes. So in the feature of space, there are multiple attributes. So this structure we had already seen that in polynomial regression. Apart from that, there are many other kind of things you had already seen that. And in separate also, you had seen the multiple regression. Now here situation is more general in the framework that here we are talking just these things definitely by default would come, but here we are talking about multivariate nature of response. Till now response was univariant. Okay, so it was taking simple y was a random variable. That means it was taking value from real number. Now onward in multivariate regression, it is different. That means it is having various attribute y1, y or various components. You can say that y1, y2 up to depends upon what kind of yq, how many attribute you want for y. Okay. So like if you want to based on diet, exercise and other kind of things, suppose y1 is talking about height response, y2 is talking about weight response, and likewise yq is talking about something else, some that IQ level or something like that, it would talk about. So if you are dealing with various responses in together based on attribute, the given attribute or input, then what will happen, that means you are dealing with a multivariate response, so that a structure will come in together. Okay, so we will study that in detail and discuss how to handle that kind of model, that how we can handle multivariate linear model. So again, I am saying that framework is linear here. Okay, so coming to that linear multivariate linear model. Before that, we need to discuss about one very interesting kind of multiplication of two matrices. That one is defined, introduced by Kronecker. That we are calling it a Kronecker product. So it is just a very interesting kind of product of two matrices. How we do? So such kind of matrix product we will apply in the framework of converting multivariate linear model into multiple linear model. So that's where it is very much essential. So just I will try to understand this one through example. So suppose we are taking one matrix A having four entries, and that means 2 by 2. We have taken 2 by 2 matrix having four entries 2 0 1 3, and we are taking another matrix B with entries 5, minus 1, minus 1, 4. Again, B is also 2 by 2 matrix. Okay. Now, after that, suppose you are willing to perform a Kronecker product of matrix A with B, then what is meaning of that? That means each entry of A has been multiplied with the full matrix B. That is the concept of Kronecker product. So, here take entry 2, the first entry of the matrix A, and multiply with matrix B, then we are getting twice of B. And everyone aware of matrix multiplication of any matrix, what is meaning of a scalar multiplication of matrix? That means how we multiply a scalar number with matrix. So when we multiply a scalar number with matrix, then that scalar will be multiplied with every entry of that matrix. So that's why we will see that in detail. So here what we do in Kronecker product, so we are taking this one entry, this entry we multiply with B, then we take second entry 0, we multiply with the matrix B again. Then we are taking this entry and we multiply with matrix B, second matrix B, and we are taking, after that we are taking this entry and we multiply with again the second matrix B. So in that process we will see that there is an increase in the order of the matrix. So how further we will expand this, because it is we know that the Kronecker delta Kronecker product have converted this matrix into what a scalar multiple of matrix. So it is, if you try to see each individual, then in this first you can say that it is what, it is a sub matrix. submatrix under this Kronecker product. So it is talk about first submatrix. How we are getting it? We are multiplying the second matrix B with a scalar 2 that happens to be first entry of A. And after multiplying 2 with each this matrix B, that means we need to multiply 2 with each entry of B. That means 2 times 5, 10. 2 times minus 1 is minus 2. 2 times minus 1 is minus 2. And 2 times 8 is 2 times 4 is 8. So that's why we are getting this one. In the second submatrix, what we observe here, we multiply the second entry of A that happens to be 0 with B, and we know that 0 is having absorbing capacity. That means whenever you multiply 0 with any number, it just convert that into 0. So that's way any non-zero number, that and then it would be converted into 0. So we are multiplying 0 with matrix B, so all the four entries of matrix B, it would be 0, and it will come in this here as a sub matrix. Okay, now we'll talk about third sub matrix. This one, this is the third sub matrix. What we do here? Here we just multiply 1 with B. That means every entry of B would be multiplied with 1, and we know that if you're multiplying with 1, there would be no change, any change in the entry of B. So that's why we are getting the same matrix B as a submatrix of this Kronecker product. Okay, this is the submatrix, third submatrix. Now we'll talk about last one, that happens to be fourth submatrix. How we will get this one? We will get through this definition approach. That means we are multiplying the matrix B thrice times, three times. That means 5 will be raised to 15, minus 3, 1 will be raised to minus 3, minus 1 would be raised to minus 3, and 4 would be raised to 12. So in that process, here you can see that it was A was 2 by 2 matrix. This one B was 2 by 2 matrix, and after the result through Kronecker product, what kind of matrix we are observing it here? So you can observe that this one is a 4 by 4 matrix, so the dimension has been increased. You can dimension of the matrix has been increased. That's why really this kind of multiplication is really interesting, and we'll see it further what kind of application it will find in the process of understanding a multivariate regression or multivariate linear model. So here we are taking a response variable with s number of attribute, and for each response, simply so s number of attribute, that means we are saying that it is a vector, s vector, simply we can say that. And there are n number of observation, that means there is a sample of size n. We are observing n times, that means there are n person. And suppose you can compare with s attribute like height, weight, and other various other kind of things would come there. Those would be attribute, and n observation, that means there are n person. With respect to those n person, we are collecting data of those s number of attribute. Okay, so that is the overall perspective. Okay, so we had seen in the univariate linear model that concern an n vector of response due to that n observation. That means n times we observe y with respect to n number of sample points. So that's why we are getting n dimensional vector of responses. Okay, that there are n number of responses with all observation. Further, what we put condition here, all the observation of those responses happens to be independent to each other. Why? Because the error what we had taken independent, so that's why we are putting this independent nature of the over the each value of the response. So independent nature. Okay, so the multivariate linear model, if you try to come up to generalize this univariate linear model to multivariate linear model, so in the multivariate linear model that allow generalize the response vector, here it will be not a n dimensional vector, response vector, it would be n times P response matrix, that we denote it by capital Y. And with so here we will observe that here some observation might be independent or dependent, depends upon situation what is there. That's where PCA will play a very important role in this category. So depending upon the task at hand, it may be more convenient to express N by P, the response matrix. We can call it the N by P Y, capital Y. It is the response matrix we are getting with respect to multivariate regression or linear model. So in term of, so if you try to see in the response matrix, what we observe that we can write the response matrix in two different approach. One approach we are calling it column picture, another approach we are calling it row picture, and with respect to that we will see multiple regression. Okay, so in term of its row picture, there would be n number of rows, and we will denote that with capital YI. Like it is a very universal notation that if you are talking about matrix and you will say what is the general ij element, then we denote it by aij, where I varies from 1 to n, depends upon what size, what is the size of matrix. Suppose this matrix size is m by n, then you can say that there are m number of rows. That means I will vary from 1 to m, and j is talking about columns. So how many columns you observe? N number of columns, because matrix is m by n. So that's where j will vary from 1 to 2, so it will go up to n. This is the concept of the matrix what we observe. Okay, so there are here simply we can say that is matrix, there are m number of rows and n number of columns. So here same concept we are borrowing here for the better understanding of response matrix. There are n number of rows that contains yi, the data for one person, ith person, click data for ith person, that various data, various attribute what you measure. And another representation is column picture. There what is happening that here it contains different response variables. So different response variable, one response response attribute will have different response variable will have different value for with respect to different person. That's where this here it is talking about column, having column picture of the response vector or response matrix. Okay, so if you try to further discuss about the representation of Y, so this one representation we are calling it row representation, column representation. So there are p number of column, because y is n by p response matrix. That's where we are having p number of columns, and each column happens to be what it is having a certain direction. So how many, it depends upon how many measurement we are taking. And suppose we are taking n measurement, so dimension would be, it will go that y1 will observe n number of values, likewise y2 will observe n number of value, likewise yp will observe n number of value. Okay, so if you talk about from that perspective, then there is another representation of y as a what we call it, this one is the column picture, this one is the row picture, this one is the column picture. Okay, so how it is coming, like, okay, you can see that here Y is talking about columns, columns are coming here, capital Y is, these are talking about rows, Y1 is talking about first row. So rows representation, I had already mentioned that if something is not given here, one vector by default, nothing is mentioned by default, consider that vector, what it, you consider it as a column vector. So that's why you can put here dash in order to further consider this one is a row, like Y2 dash, this one would be second row of matrix, response matrix Y. Okay, in the case of multivariate regression, and this one would be what, nth row. Okay, now what is the question here? So the question would be that we try to express Y as a linear with a linear structure in term of what we call it, input vector, input attribute. Okay, input here Y itself is a vector, having vector representation. So we try to get a hypothetical function in term of Y and theta. And definitely, when we are defining a hypothesis function, there must be error term as well. So capital E is talking about error term, okay, and theta is talking about the unknown parameter that we are willing to estimate, or we okay. So here again, theta has to be matrix in power, and this one is talking about column representation, this one is talking about row representation. That means the theta 1 dash, you can call it, it is the first row, theta 2 dash, it is the second row, and theta nth dash, it is the nth row. So this is the picture of theta, the unknown, where each theta happens to be unknown to each other. And this one is the Gaussian noise. For simplicity and for better understanding of the problem, we are just proceeding with Gaussian noise. Just this is the desired Gaussian noise with which we can proceed. And after just putting all these things in together in the linear framework, then we can write the multivariate linear model as y equal to x times theta plus epsilon, capital epsilon. So remember that here each term, what is involved here, happens to be matrix. This one is matrix, this one is matrix, this one is matrix. So each term here in this linear model happens to be a matrix representation. So if you are having matrix representation, then we will talk about it. That means we have already got the linear representation of multivariate model. So we are having now, we try to get a better picture of this one for utilization. So first we would like to talk about column picture of this multivariate linear model. So how we can get a column picture of this one? So column picture, easily we can get it by doing a vectorization of matrix and the vectorization of all the associated terms. So vectorization, that means if we are having a matrix, and then either row wise or column wise, we try to put all the entry in a single column in order to get a vectorized form of the matrix. So that's way here, if P is relatively less, then there would be no issue with vectorization process. So in vectorization process, what we do, we write the we try to write the matrix Y in term of the column matrix. So we can observe that there are how many columns we observe. So here column Y1, Y2, YP, we can talk about like this way. So here we are getting a representation of this one, like X1 times theta 1, X times and theta 2, like X times theta P plus error term. And if you try to see further closely, then what is this one? This product is actually talking about outer product of identity matrix IP and the data. Here the matrix X, this X matrix or attribute matrix or input matrix, whatever you are willing to proceed with, you can call it based on that approach. So this product of IP with X is defined with respect to canonical product. So that's why the computation would be much faster and easier, that we can see it here. Okay, so if you just implement the canonical product of IP, that identity matrix of P by P order, then what will happen is that here we can get a representation of this one after canonical delta multiplication. We see that the diagonal row along the diagonal entry, we can observe that the matrix X is coming, okay, only max X coming, and these are the parameter and these are the error. And from here we can distribute the this multivariate linear model into multiple linear model. Here this is the multiple linear model, you can observe that. So here why, for various J we will get a various model, very okay. So that's why we have converted this multivariate linear model into multiple linear model. So that is the conversion process, and once we are able to convert in this process, job is done. Job would be verified. Okay. Now next picture we'll talk about row picture of the same linear model. Okay. So we had enough discussion over multiple regression and multiple linear models. So you can borrow that in order to solve multivariate linear model problem. Okay. So what is the row picture? So row picture, it says that if you are taking a multivariate linear model, x equal to y equal to x times e. This one is capital epsilon actually. So it can be, first what we do, we have to vectorize again this multivariate linear model, but in different perspective. That means first we need to find transpose, that we are just trying to proceed with a row framework. So that's where row framework. If you don't put transpose, that means you are just proceeding with column framework. So just the framework has been changed. So due to that, what we are getting here, we are getting vectorized representation of y transpose, how it happens to be vectorized representation of transpose of x times theta plus vectorized representation of x capital exponential of theta. Okay. So if you simplify further, then what is happening here? Substitute back everything from this multivariate linear model. What you observe it here? You will observe that further this would be written as a written as a canonical product of x with ip. You can see that here order of x and p has been ip has been changed as per the column picture. So now we do here again perform for canonical product, and after that what we are getting, this kind of matrix structure and with a unknown parametric value theta. Okay, and these are the noise. Okay, so if you further talk about what is yi transpose, you can say that it is just canonical product between x and ip. Okay, and into vectorized form theta transpose plus epsilon I transpose t. So what kind of structure we observe? That so it is now again a multiple regression. So this multiple regression is much easier than multivariate linear model. So we can solve this problem for each I. Each I, there would be n number of sample, so that's the sample point. So that's why for each I we are trying to solve the multiple linear regression. So that is the job that we have already able to convert the multivariate linear model into what we call it multiple linear model in two different perspective. One perspective I am saying that it is a row picture that we got it here, and another perspective was column picture. So this is the things that we are going to, with this lecture we are